Sawasdee, and welcome to another media cast here on the Funket Pod. It's Friday, and you know what that means. And finally, I can say it's on a Friday. All right, before we start, the quick shout-out reminder, do check what's happening in the world. Check what's happening in Myanmar still, even though there's nothing about it in the media anymore. Check what's happening in Gaza, Israel, Palestine, and so on, even though there's nothing in the media anymore. It's still worth checking out. It's not just gone just because the media doesn't report about it anymore. We talked about it last time, and I'm working still on getting someone on the air who will talk with us about all those things and maybe even be able to explain why things are happening the way they are happening. So stay tuned for this, hopefully making this happen rather soon. But without further ado, let's just jump right into what I wanted to talk about today, because there are lots of topics that I came across this past week and I thought it might be interesting to talk about. The first one, however, is a topic that's just of interest. Well, actually, it should be interesting to everybody, but it hit rather, I don't know, it hit home, basically, simply because it happened at home. Well, home being Thailand right now. So, and I'm smiling. And if you want more details, check out my Thailand Tuesday podcast every Tuesday about everything Thailand. I just mentioned right now because it's media related and it's just such a great example of it's 2021, but man, things are still happening. So what I'm talking about is... If you're a foreigner and you go to the immigration and you want to make an appointment for, I don't know, 90 days report or whatever you will have to do, there's a website for that, right? So you go to the immigrationthailand.com website and you click make an appointment. You have to enter your name, your passport number, of course, your visa and so on. And then they give you an appointment. Now someone figured out, hey, wait, there's no HTTPS. It's not a secure website. Let's see what else we can do. And you don't even need to hack. You just need to go to like immigrationthailand.com/, and then, I don't know, I'm making this up right now, the path, right? Database or whatever the path is. And you see all the data from everybody who used the freaking website to make an appointment at the immigration. Luckily, within like a day, it got so much traction thanks to like one of the famous Thailand Twitter users, Richard Barrow, tweeting it. It got so much traction that then the immigration in Thailand just shut it down and just closed down that hole, apparently. But man, that's like, if I set up a WordPress blog right now, which takes me, I don't know, 10 to 20 minutes or something, depending how fast the servers update, that's safer than this. It's ridiculous, right? And the same thing happened with the vaccination website. So there's a website here in Thailand, a website where you as a foreigner can register for the vaccine if you are 60 years and older and whatnot. I talk about all those things on the Thailand Tuesday. Same thing though. You leave like all your data, everything there, and then you just add like / database or whatever the path is, and you get all the information. It's frigging 2021. If you seriously set up a WordPress page, that's gonna be way more secure than this by default. Like, how in the does a government agency F this up? It's, hey, Thai immigration, if you need a secure website, here's your guy. Let me help you. I give you a friendly price, of course. Just like those street lamps that cost like 70 billion baht or something. Again, check the Thailand Tuesday for this reference. Okay, I just want to give you a few media and Thailand-related news. Don't worry, it's not all Thailand. In fact, I'm stopping with Thailand right now and I'll jump into something more controversial that will probably also give me some flack. Here we go. So, BBC News says the teen who filmed the George Floyd murder was given a journalism award. So it was given like some special, and let me check my notes, some special Pulitzer, how do I say it in American English? Pulitzer, a Pulitzer Prize, right? So the biggest award for journalism was given to that kid who filmed George Floyd being murdered. So, of course, so there has been lots of talks over the past few years. Has it been like a year, 2 years? There's so many things happening. It's hard to say how much time has passed, but there's been so much made of it, right? Should that kid, teenager, have intervened, for example? Like, why are you only filming? Why aren't you intervening? And things like this. So we're not here to cast blame or anything, because what are you going to do against the police, right? But now that's where I'm going to get the flag. Why do you give a journalism prize to a kid who was just teenager, sorry, randomly standing there and just filming something that happened. So it's like, there's no, I don't know why. That's not extremely courageous. There's no context there. There's no journalistic work there. So I think they're doing this because they want to be woke and they want to still keep riding the George Floyd wave. And while I say this, I can already see like the keyboard warriors being like, oh, God. No, I'm very sympathetic, obviously. I mean, we all are on the side of George Floyd's family and we're all happy that the murderer got sentenced. I think he got like, they found him guilty for all the three accounts that he was on trial for, I believe, right? So, yes, of course, we're all on the right side, I hope. But giving the teenager a journalism award, like, why? It's unnecessary. Yep. And this just brings the spotlight back onto the issue, just to rile up more people again, just to make people, I don't know, panic again, get going to like, oh, yeah, right, oh, those a-holes from the police and so on. So I don't see there any benefit besides just trying to please the woke audience, the woke mass, and to just say, hey, look at us, we're super woke, we're cool. Pulitzer Prize is still something important because no one talks about it. Let's be honest. When's the last time you talked about a Pulitzer Prize? Exactly. So we are still relevant. I think that's the main reason why they did it, and that are the wrong reasons to do that, in my opinion. And that's why we should shame and blame, shame bell right here, the Pulitzer board or whoever decides who gets the prize there. And now I know I'm not jealous, but I think, I mean, Funkipot would obviously also deserve a Pulitzer Prize. No, but seriously, right? So my sympathies with that, I think it was a girl, was it, a teenager, who had to watch this and witness this, because it's definitely not easy, obviously. So, like, all the sympathies with her, obviously all the sympathies and feelings for George Floyd's family and so on, and everybody involved. But I just think, and I'm not saying they don't deserve anything or they don't deserve attention or whatever it is, they do. But I think the Pulitzer Prize committee just awards the Pulitzer Prize to the teenager just so they stay relevant, stay in the news, get the spotlight on them, and make people go like, yeah, that's the right decision, you're cool. So they want to be woke, and I think they do it for the wrong reasons, and that's why I have a problem with it. Let me know what you think. Maybe I'm completely off. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe it's just they're just being, or they're just doing the right thing, and you agree with it. Let me know. I'm happy to change my mind if you can explain it to me. So I just think they do it just so they are in the news. But speaking of journalism and I know news and so on, there's one thing, and I have it at the end of this podcast as a recommendation one more time, but there's like this one show in the US that I kind of like when it comes to political news and so on, which is Breaking Points. You're probably aware of Breaking Points with Crystal and Saga. Crystal Bell and Saga and Jetty, I believe, are the last names. They used to be on The Hill or work for The Hill. But now, I think a month ago or so, they left The Hill and now they're doing it by themselves. And that's pretty cool. So, A, I like kind of like the show. I'm not necessarily very fond of them as individuals, like the way they portray themselves on social media. I try to follow them for a bit and try to see like what they're about. I unfollowed both of them again because I wasn't really, didn't really take or get much from their social media postings. But I mean, that's fair enough. It's your private life, so do whatever you want. Their politics show is cool. Yeah, and so it's always like Saga, the more right-wing guy, Crystal Ball, the more left-wing leaning moderator, reporter, I don't know what to say there actually, and they go through different topics and then they look from different viewpoints onto those topics, which is kind of nice. And so now they don't work for The Hill anymore, they do it like by themselves. So it's kind of like the first independent politics show, I believe, in the US, which is kind of cool. And why do I mention this? Well, A, just to sing some praise, but they don't need it because they've just been on Joe Rogan, so everybody knows them anyways. But it's just cool to see that even though in 2020, where it's like all controlled by big conglomerates, by, I don't know, Warner and whatnot, Fox and whoever owns Fox. We had a whole podcast on this, and we're going to do another one on this soon. Disney owns everything anyways. it's just cool to see that they can break out and still be successful and create like their own thing, which I find like very empowering, very powerful. And I'm very motivated. After seeing this, I'm like, yeah, I'm going to just go over into my other room, set up a studio, and going to start creating stuff again, because I'm motivated seeing that they do it. And I'm like, I want to, not the same thing, but I just also want to create stuff again, because it's just cool. And apparently, good content still works. And that's just nice to see. So congratulations to Breaking Points with Crystal and Saga. Great job. I'm assuming you're listening to this podcast or you're watching this on YouTube. Obviously, I'm talking to Crystal and Saga right now. Please feel free to come on the pod or come to one of my classes and talk to my students about how to make all those things happen. That would be awesome. All right. If you haven't yet, if you're one of those few hundred people listening to me and you haven't heard Crystal and Saga, check it out. It's called Breaking Points. It's on YouTube, I believe, too. And I'm sure they also have the podcast feed. I always watch the videos. Check it out. They deserve it. So, okay, enough praise here. Maybe we do a whole episode on like breaking down how they became successful and how they utilize their audience and so on. Because it's obviously smart, because one of them is left, but the other one is right. And so they have like both audiences there, and they try to find like some grounds in the middle, and then they try to explain it to each other and so on. So it's kind of nice. So smart move. A smart approach, of course, but also a smart move to move away from mainstream media and doing it like independently. So congratulations. Looking forward to seeing where this goes. Okay, let's move on, though, because there's so much on the list today. Last week and the week before, I talked a lot about Naomi Osaka, mental health, journalism, mental health in the media, and so on. And so I'm just adding one thing, because I read it while I was preparing today's show. So Wimbledon organizers, they contacted Naomi Osaka and they said they begin consultation on media engagement. So they apparently are not like Roland Garros, the French Open. No, it's not. That's not the same, right? You can see I'm a tennis specialist. So anyways, Wimbledon is not like the French Open or Roland Garros. Is it the same? But they're not saying like, oh, we're going to ban you, or you have to pay that much fine. They're like, hey, Naomi, we want you to play. We want you to feel safe. We want you to be secure. What can we do? And that might be the right step, right? Of course, it also comes on the heels of basically every big brand out there speaking up for Naomi Osaka. Like all her sponsors, Nike in the forefront and so on, said, yep, we stand with Naomi Osaka. Mental health matters. We completely support her. I think the app Calm, like a meditation app and stuff, they said, I'm not sure if they sponsor her, but they said if she ever has to pay a fine again for not showing to a press conference, they cover their fine, yeah, which is also pretty cool and of course also brings spotlight onto them. So I think that's the right step by Wimbledon. Of course, they'd also do it to be in the media, like, hey, look how mentally or how aware we are of mental health. But fair enough in this case, because it's related to what's happening right now. And if that then ends up with A, Naomi Osaka playing there, and B, shining light on mental health issues, I'm all for it. So Wimbledon, I usually don't give props to anything British, being German. We got more World Cup still, but let's not talk about the European Championships. That's the right move, I think. So yes, Wimbledon, for once you got things right. Not going to talk about that the rest of England is still locked down, while Wimbledon can have fans in attendance, like full capacity fans, but in other parts of England you can't go out, you can't have dinner together, and you're still locked down. Not going to talk about this here on the podcast, because it's a media cast, not a politics cast. But if you want to talk about it, shout out in the comments or via email, of course. Okay. We're sticking with like media images and what happens in the media. And one more thing that I found this week, and I just want to mention very briefly, and maybe you'll again let me know what you think about it. So we just had the G7 summit and all those things, and then of course Biden would meet Putin and so on. And now Putin came out on, I think, the Moscow news, whatever, and he said, and I quote, he said, Biden's media image has nothing to do with reality. So Putin says, while the media in Russia, as well as the American media, portrays Biden to be like, I don't know, not fully there, like a bit clumsy and so on. He says, in real life, it's actually not like this. In real life, Joe Biden is very smart, very at it, understands everything, is a very fast thinker. And Putin is looking forward to communicating more with the US again if the Biden administration wants to. So that's clearly like just trying to be nice here right now and being like, hey, I like you, you're cool, let's just talk. He called him, and I quote, Biden is a professional. You have to be very attentive in working with him so as not to miss something, because he does not miss a thing. Trust me. That's what Putin said. That's a quote from Moscow Today or something. So now they're trying, is that an English phrase too? Correct me if I'm wrong. Like, I know in Germany we say you put like honey around the beard. Is that an English phrase? I should read this up, or maybe I should have a Flula Borg inspired podcast where I just literally translate German stuff into English, just for the laughs and giggles. Anyway, so he's trying to be nice to Biden right now, of course, to say like, hey, Joe, I like you. Come on, talk to me. I think that's obviously the goal here, and he's using media to achieve this, because if he just says them for himself, it's like, yeah, we all know you can say stuff by yourself or like within a small circle. If you use the media, like, oh, he really means it. Wow, look at this. He said it publicly. He really likes me. Smart move by Putin here. Let's see if Biden bites and just, I don't know, relaxes restrictions, opens more communication channels. Who knows? Since we're already with like the land of the free and so on, I have one more thing that I found kind of interesting in this case. So the U.S. military Special Operations Command, they reinstated their head of, and let me check this from my nose, the head of diversity, following an investigation that concluded there were no violations of laws or Defense Department regulations in controversial social media posts. So this head of diversity got moved to another position because this head of diversity had social media posts on social media before he got hired that were controversial of Donald Trump. They were mocking Donald Trump. They were mocking Ted Cruz, I believe, as well. But now the U.S. Military Special Operations Command came to the conclusion saying, yeah, well, actually, we are not allowed to vet social media information profiles, posts that were made before the hire. So we can only judge you by the posts that you make after you got hired. Meaning the stuff that you post about Trump and Cruz and so on before you were hired didn't matter. So that's why the head of diversity is reinstated as head of diversity. Remember in our last podcast last week, we talked about how much, or 2 weeks ago actually, how much should the past, the stuff that you posted in the past, follow you into the present, right? Did you change? Maybe you became a better person. In this case, it's just been a year old and they say, we move on. It's not who you are right now. So it's kind of cool. Kind of also, they only want to avoid being in the news and having more troubles, I believe, of course. But if everyone would handle it like this, might it be easier? But then again, shouldn't you be held responsible for the things that you say, even though it's been a year ago? Shouldn't you still be responsible for what you said back then? Shouldn't we be like, hey, you say something today, and then you move on like, hey, that's what I said yesterday. It doesn't matter anymore. Difficult, right? It's a very difficult situation, like with the Kevin Hart situations and the Oscars and so on. I'm curious again, what do you think about this? Should you be held responsible for what you said? Or should we move on? Or is there a middle way? It's like, yeah, if you say something super insulting that's clearly, I don't know, racist, for example, you will be held responsible to that for the rest of your life. But if it's something that is just like in the heat or spur of the moment, then maybe you just look over it, because you of course develop, you become more mature and so on. Again, I'm looking forward to your responses either in the comment section, social media at FunkitPod, or via email funkitpod@gmail.com. All right. Now let's also look into, of course, a little bit into the social media sphere, since you probably consume this on some kind of social medium, podcasting, maybe even it's a bit social. So our all dad of social media, Mark Zuckerberg, he said augmented reality can replace art and media. So he says, and I will tell you in a second why he says that. He says digital holograms will eventually be able to replace TV, books, and even art installations like paintings, sculptures, and so on. He says everyone's going to wear augmented reality glasses, and that's why AR is going to become like a huge thing and going to replace everything, basically. Now, why does he say that? A, probably because he believes it. And I mean, sure, Facebook is involved in Oculus, which is VR. So they're also doing lots of AR stuff. We've seen it like 2 years ago or so that they also had like their virtual world and everything, right? And that you have kind of like meetings with your avatars and stuff like this. But now, what they just also announced is a launch of connected glasses. It's called Connected Glass, I believe. And they're going to collab with Ray-Ban. I didn't know that it fits together. Facebook X Ray-Ban or something. Ray-Ban. I mean, it's a world-famous glasses brand, obviously. I just don't see Facebook being like this, like a cool fashion brand. Says the guy with a fake fashion shirt on. But that means that says Sabai Sabai, and of course it's in the font of Supreme, and yes, it's an intertextual reference, and it's on purpose. And Sabai Sabai means chill, calm down. It's a saying here in Thailand, but that's on purpose. I'm just saying. But yeah, back to Facebook and Ray-Ban. I don't see that being cool, to be honest, but while I look like a style icon, I'm not always completely right with those things. So maybe the connected glasses with Ray-Ban and Facebook will be amazing, and we're all gonna run and buy them and end up in all AR worlds after that. Just like the Snapchat goggles were like a huge success. All right, moving on. What else happened this past week? Well, the E3 concluded on Tuesday, and while I'm not the biggest gamer in the world, I still appreciate games, of course. And there were a few cool trailers out there that I mentioned. I wrote down my three favorites. So one of them, of course, being Halo Infinite, because Halo is just a classic, of course. The trailer is like what you would expect from an action movie / game. You see him floating through space, and then the space station, I was looking for the word, I'm sorry, not a native speaker, the space station there, and then you see like dead bodies and stuff, and then you grab the weapon and you have like this voice in your head, and then you see the hologram that survived, that was placed to take out Cortana, but then the hologram should have been terminated automatically, but didn't, so something went wrong, and now you're there to figure out what went wrong. So it's like really movie-like trailer, which makes you go like, yes, let's play Halo again. That is kind of cool. Even cooler is then my second favorite trailer. So Halo is number third, and the second favorite trailer on the second place is Outer Worlds 2. Because Outer Worlds 2 makes like a mockery of all those action trailers. Like, yeah, you hear a deep voice talking. And they actually say this, so they make a mockery out of like those typical action trailers that we just watched with Halo Infinite. So that's amazing. So and then you see people running and shooting in slow motion. And you see you see a monster that's not going to be in the game. You see the superhero and it pans out. You see like someone from the back, like a silhouette, basically. And that's all you see because I don't know, the game design isn't finished yet. The levels aren't finished yet. Actually, nothing is finished yet. They only know the name. It was like Outer Worlds 2. Hilarious trailer. I really like it. Don't know what's going to happen with the game. But if the trailer, their prototype trailer is an indicator, this should be a fun game, of course. Number one on my list of trailers from E3, and you can then now probably guess my age, is Far Cry. Far Cry 6 is coming, and you see me smiling. It's not often that I really look forward to a new game, but I remember when I played Far Cry 1 for the first time, and I couldn't even play it myself. I was at a friend of mine because he had a way better computer back then than I had, because it wouldn't run on my computer, to be honest. I think I had a Dell laptop back then when I was at uni or something. So I went to my friend and he showed me, he's like, you have to check out Far Cry. I'm like, I'm not into computer games, man, come on. And then he turned on Far Cry and I'm like, wow, that's amazing. And I got lost in the Far Cry world, of course. And I haven't played Far Cry in a while, to be honest, though. So I haven't played much of Far Cry 5, which was a bit controversial in the beginning with like this setting, right, of like this crazy family in the US. Now Far Cry 6 brings you to South America, I believe, and It has like, oh, I forgot the name. I should have written down the name. Sorry. It has like the narrator is like the guy from Breaking Bad. Oh, I forgot the name. You know who I mean, right? So he's narrating it, and he's narrating it like his daughter. I'm not sure, like, or his apprentice, like a girl, then explaining like how to be like a really good, I know, fighter for freedom, because you're the freedom fighter there, and trying to protect or free your people from the grip of the cartels and so on. Yeah, but it's not going to be politically, I know, correct or so, because you just run around and quote trailer, blast or blow things up. it looks amazing. It looks amazing. The storyline seems like fair enough to be involved in it. There are lots of jokes in there also, lots of references. I'm looking forward to this. Far Cry 6, you got me excited. I'm looking forward to this. What I'm not so excited about is, I saw a few articles out there. I think one was also Wired or The Verge. I kind of forgot, to be honest. Check it. I don't know. I read all those things. It's all a blur. But I actually also wrote it down as a note. So Nintendo, right? I haven't been that excited about Nintendo for a while now. And they published something now. They made Metroid Dread with lots of game nerds, I think, excited. Me not so much, and for me it's more like Nintendo has been a bit stale over the past few years. I mean, they still come up with like games for the Switch, but I don't know why I'm not that excited about Nintendo anymore. To be fair though, I've never been a Nintendo guy. I've grew up with Sega, cause let's be honest, hedgehogs are way cooler than Italian plumbers. But yeah, I'm not that excited about Nintendo right now. Let me know if you see it differently. Tell me if your favorite Switch games, maybe that will convert me again. But since we're already in the gaming thing, and I have to zoom in because my eyes are getting bad, for those watching, for those not. So I have some notes here, and shall we go? Yeah, let's go down the road, at least for a short time. So, there are some racist, I don't know, there's some people out there that say Dungeons and Dragons is racist. And some fans now want to replace the races within D&D with two more nuanced concepts like ancestry and culture. Now the question is it a good idea? Make it more politically correct? Does it take away the gameplay fun? Does it change the gameplay? And here I'm not sure. I'm not the biggest D&D fan, to be honest. I mean, I played a little bit back then when I was younger. But changing the game? At first, I became defensive, even though I'm not a D&D fan. But I'm like, hey, it's been part of the game culture the way it was for a long time right now. So why you want to change it? Then I thought about it. I'm like, well, I mean, culture changes, people change, communication changes, media changes. So why shouldn't games change too? But then I thought again, do we need to be super PC? Do we need to be super woke? If you don't like it, if it doesn't fit, don't play it. And for those who still like it, still play it. It's like with Friends, right? Do you need to edit Friends so it fits the current culture more? No, if you think it doesn't fit the current culture, you don't like it, you don't watch it. If I think, hey, I want a throwback to the 2000s, I'm going to watch it because I like it. But then what does it say about you as a media consumer? You consume Friends, are you racist? You play D&D, maybe you're racist. So many layers in there. Again, I want to know, what do you think? Because for me, it's hard to make a decision here. I would say, hey, if you think D&D is racist, don't play it, create your own game, create a different game, make it a better game. But again, I want to hear what do you say? What do you think about this, that D&D is racist? And the last thing that I saw, like when I did like this E3 wrap-up and so on, I think it was on The Guardian. I know, don't come at me with The Guardian, but it popped up in my Facebook feed. I know Facebook. The Guardian had an article saying, video game anxiety is real, here's how to manage it. All right, so, and then they say even like positive video games, like not only like those video games that go like onto your nerves and like very tense, but even like those fun video games can produce or lead to anxiety. No shit, Guardian. Everything you do can lead to anxiety. And these days, apparently, also everything does lead to anxiety because anxiety is the first thing that everybody mentions. Like, I've got anxiety. Okay, then stop doing it. So I'm very sympathetic towards anxiety. I understand anxiety. I understand it sucks. But we don't need to make everything like a huge deal, right? So if there is video game anxiety, stop playing the video game. And I know if you're addicted, and so that's a different level. So you're addicted, you can't stop it. You go down this long and lonely road. I've seen people succumbing to this, not taking too lightly, I promise. Because I've seen people going down that road. That's a different thing. Yeah, but just saying, hey, you're so stressed because playing video games is very stressful. But if you play online with so many people, and then they're all in your ear, and you have to do this and you have this, and you can. Then stop it. That's one of the reasons why I also don't do like multiplayer games and stuff like this. I can't handle it. I'm annoyed by it. Like, there's too much happening. Makes me anxious. I'm an introvert person. I don't like people. Except those listening or watching my podcast. Then I don't do it. I'm sorry. I know this is a very, maybe rednecky approach to things. But you don't need to make everything about crazy anxiety, and you don't need to have an article telling us that if you play games you're gonna end up with anxiety. I just think that's just too much moral panic here again. It's just like, hey, we haven't had game stuff in a while, and now games are obviously booming during the pandemic. Esports are booming. Let's just make an article about the E3 just happened. Let's just make an article about how terrible games are. Too obvious. Find something better. And I think it was The Guardian. If it wasn't The Guardian, I'm sorry for hating on The Guardian, but, it's The Guardian. Another thing on The Guardian, I don't know, to be honest, but something out of the UK. Social media stars under fire for ignoring rules on advertising. So the UK has very strict rules on advertising. So, hey, good on you, UK. It's the second positive thing I say about the UK. But I think the rest of Europe does the same, though. Germany has the same rules, so just saying. Anyways, the rules are you have to clearly indicate that you are posting something as an ad. If you are an influencer, great job title, by the way. Hey, Grandpa, how did you make your money? I was an influencer. Huh? Nice. Anyway, so lots of influencers, they posted ads without making it clear that those are ads. And now the Advertising Standards Authority has a roll call out there. So they basically name and shame influencers that are doing this. Like, hey, this influencer posted this ad. They didn't disclose it. Shame on them. Shame bell. It's kind of funny. I'm kind of on the side of the authority here in this case. It doesn't happen that often. But yeah, in this case, you go for it. UK Advertising Standards Authority. Shame all those influencers. I'm all for it. Let me know what you think again. All for it. Since we are now already on social media, let's continue the social media talk. Amazon, the favorite company of everybody, Amazon. Goodbye, Jeff Bezos. Will he ever return from space? Did you hear you all heard that he's going to space with his brother, right? It's a 90-minute flight. And they had a spare seat. Basically, they auctioned off that spare seat to someone for $28 million for a 90-minute rocket ride. And you have to pay your own flights. Not even included. What the hell? Let's see how this goes. And let's see when Richard Branson goes up. And let's see when Elon Musk goes up. Whew, the space race is real. Okay, but Amazon, back to Earth. Amazon blames social media for the struggle with fake reviews. They say social networking sites are too slow to act when warned that fake reviews are being solicited on their platforms. So in this case, I would like to offer a minute of silence for Amazon. Ha ha. Seriously, Amazon? That's so nice. There are fake reviews. There are fake reviews. How about you be a better brand and you make sure that the it you're selling meets standards and expectations? Just saying. They say, let me quote again. Amazon blames social media companies for its failure to remove fake reviews from the website, arguing that bad actors turn to social networks to buy and sell fake product reviews outside the reach of its own technology. That is very sad, Amazon. That is very sad, and I very much feel for you. They say they removed more than 200 million suspected fake reviews in 2020. Crazy, before they were even published or seen by others. That's a crazy number, right? Whew, that's, I need to get into the fake review business, I think. Buy fake AmazonReviews.com. .coth. Huh. Anyways, it feels hard to feel sympathetic for Amazon because it's Amazon, but if that's the case, I mean, fake reviews just suck anyways because it just distorts the image and you want to rely on something and then it's all fake reviews. But you know, I mean, we all know that you shouldn't relate on reviews. I mean, we all know that by now, so I mean, it doesn't really bother me that much, to be honest, but it would be nice if all the reviews would be sincere, of course. Okay, staying on social media, IG launches real ads in all regions globally. Nice, hey! Taking the one thing that didn't have ads from us, so now there are also ads in all reels in all regions. Nice. Thank you, Instagram, Facebook, Mark. Great. Another thing that I read, also related to social media, there were four bills brought forward, I think, in the US, according to Reuters. And Reuters said those four bills could lead to the following. And I'm just going to tell you those four points, the main points in those bills, and quickly give you my take on it, and then hopefully also get your take on it. So they say, okay, first is a law against platforms giving preference to their own products on their platforms. Huh. So for example, Google would no longer be able to promote its own products in search. Apple wouldn't be allowed to preference Apple Music over Spotify and so on. Huh. How do you control that? I mean, it's a nice law, it's a nice rule, like, hey, be impartial, but then how do you control that? Maybe by chance, all YouTube videos are just better optimized for search engine, for the Google search engine, than Vimeo videos. So how are you going to control that? But it's a nice idea, like having like an even playing field. But then again, I'm confused why that's a thing in the US. Like this even comes forward because it's like all, isn't all capitalism in the US? Like, if you are a company like Google that produces or creates a platform for the people to use for free, shouldn't the company be able to say what's on there? Freedom of speech, freedom of making money. What do you think? It's a cute idea. Never going to happen. Even if it's a policy, a law, or whatever, you're gonna ask Google to give them the algorithm, and you check the algorithm to make sure that there is no preferential treatment of whatever. Even if they show you the algorithm, do you think that's the algorithm that they're actually going to use? Yeah. Okay, second thing, a restriction on business mergers in the tech sector unless the acquirer can demonstrate that the acquired company was not in competition with any product or service the platform already offers. So in this case, Facebook, for example, would not have been allowed to acquire WhatsApp or IG. Huh. Will this rule also be applied in traditional media? Hey, Disney. Again, I understand the idea, like even playing field, preventing big mergers, big conglomerates, but only in the social media, in the tech space. What about the media space? What about Disney buying basically everything? What about Rupert Murdoch buying everything else? All right, the third thing that they said should be in there in a provision, a ban on digital platforms owning subsidiaries that operate on their platform if those subsidiaries compete with other businesses. And this is aimed at reducing like preferential behavior, I think. This could even lean to, I think, sell-off of certain elements of like different companies, I believe. So interesting again, is it only going to apply to the tech space, though, or is it going to apply to the media space, to any other space as well? Like, why only on the tech space? If shouldn't it apply everywhere? Because, I mean, every conglomerate basically operates like this, right? The last thing is interesting, I believe. Improved user data portability with platforms under legal obligation to allow users to transfer their data elsewhere if they choose, including to a competing business. Yeah. Nice. I mean, you should... This should be a law of, anyways. You should always be in control of your data. You should always be able to get all your data, take it, cancel, then delete your account so that the company doesn't have the data anymore and you take your data elsewhere. I think that's just, yes. So I'm all for this one. Again, going to be hard to enforce to make sure that they actually delete your data, but all for it. So let me know what you think about those four provisions. I think their intention might be the right intention. There might be good intentions behind it. Yeah, but it's politics, so probably not. But if you only apply and force it onto the tech field, like why not onto other fields such as media, such as anything, finance and whatnot? Because all those conglomerates like work with those sloppy rule sets right now, right? So. Okay, almost there. Just a few more social media things. So Ben and Jerry's stopped using social media for a while. There are lots of comments on their posts saying like, hey, they should boycott Jerusalem and so on. Israel don't sell there anymore because of Palestine and whatnot. And so they just stopped using social media. What do you think? Right or not? Like, just don't answer. Just be like Deontay Wilder in his press conference. If you're not into sports, I'm sorry. If you're into sports, check Deontay Wilder versus Tyson Fury press conference. That was something. All right. IG also announced affiliate programs. Yay, more money making options on IG. New stars options to help provide revenue options for creators. Nice. I'm all for creators having the option to make more money. So affiliates, yeah. But this also means more ads, more posts, more advertising posts, and no, I don't want that. But what do you think? Like, are you for creators making more money because you're a creator, which is cool? But then again, it means we will see more ads and so on, or more ad-like posts, and I don't want that. Google also launches a new integration for WooCommerce in Google. Google Commerce, Google Shopping, so that you can integrate WooCommerce from your WordPress, for example, into Google Shopping. So that's just nice. Streamline it a little bit more. That's cool. Twitter will now let Spaces hosts download audio files. Yes. Clubhouse, take that. That's the one thing that's super annoying at Clubhouse, that you cannot download your talks. Twitter Spaces now says, hey, you're the host, you can download it. Yes, now I'm going to host stuff there. I'm going to host stuff there with my students. We're going to talk on Twitter Spaces. Going to download it. You can listen to it later just to recap and so on. So yes, good. Clubhouse, thank you, Twitter. Thank you, Jack. Facebook launched something else, and then we're done with this, I think. No, almost. So many things. Facebook launched a new independent artist program to provide exposure opportunities for unsigned musicians. Nice. If you're a musician, I'm not a musician, so I haven't really checked it out yet, but I will, because I know a few musicians here in Thailand as well. So I'm gonna send this to them and see what happens. So they said, okay, you're not signed, so we want you to get more exposure. So they're like free opportunities for musicians to reach a wider audience, which in theory sounds good. I just don't believe that Facebook is not going to take anything from them. There must be a clause in there where they're going to take something eventually, but for now it sounds nice. All right, last thing, IG added group fundraisers to facilitate new awareness opportunities. Yeah, also nice, but you know, we talked about this many times, Facebook always like doing like those kind of woke things in between just to be like, yeah, we're cool, we're woke, we support everyone. Let's see how this actually pans out. If it works out, it's nice. I mean, fundraising for causes that matter, I'm all for it, of course. I just don't trust Facebook or Instagram to do things just because they're good. There must be something behind there. Okay, that's about it. So I'm gonna, and by, I hope really, I'm all excited. I hope you realized, there are the words that I wanted to say. I hope you realized I did not talk about Bitcoin this time. Because my heart still broken and I'm still crying inside. No, it's not that bad, but I'm going to talk more about NFTs, blockchain, Bitcoin, and so on, cryptocurrencies in the next podcast. So I thought I'm going to save this for today, and then next week a little bit more heavy, not completely, maybe like 30% of the podcast is going to be about crypto and stuff, I'm guessing. So today we just go into like media, social media, and so on. I want to finish by again giving a recommendation. Last time I talked about a book, this time I talk about a podcast, and I mentioned it before. And yeah, it's a lame recommendation because it's a Joe Rogan podcast, so yes, everybody listens to it anyways. But to be honest, the last few weeks I haven't been that excited about the Joe Rogan podcast, but the last episode, episode 1668, with Crystal Ball and Saga and Jetty, the guys from Breaking Point that I mentioned earlier, was really cool, really interesting, really informative. Joe Rogan didn't just say yes to everything. He actually asked him a few critical questions. They could answer them, which was nice. So I really enjoyed that podcast. Also, the talk about Amazon and so on was pretty interesting. So check it out if you haven't so already. All right, that's it for the Media Friday this week. I hope to hear from you, read from you, reach out via comment section, social media, at FunkitPod everywhere, or email funkitpod@gmail.com. Until then, take care, stay safe, and I'll see you next time. Sawasdee ka.